I see a little more of my father in me. See, he loved my mother and my brother and me, and he did the best that he could. And I only hope when I have my own family, every day I'll see, oh, I hope I see, I hope every day I see a little more of my father.
Hello, I'm Byron Watson, sit with Joe Jurenik, and this is The Father's Corner, sponsored by the Coalition for Preservation of Fatherhood. The Father's Corner is dedicated to addressing the issues of men's rights in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, emphasizing probate matters, divorce, and definitely the restraining orders issued in the Commonwealth. Joe, I know you want to discuss Clark Rockefeller. Before we bring our guest on, our esteemed guest.
Well, I'll take a moment just to bring up the subject. We all know that that was a big item in the news in the last couple of weeks. And it seemed like Mr. Rockefeller had a long history of disinformation about his past, his personal history. But I found it quite striking that the fact that he took his own child was resulted in him being incarcerated. From our point of view, from the point of view of many fathers, the courts kidnap children every day, and there's no repercussion for those crimes that are committed against families and fathers in the state of Massachusetts. So it's a sad ending for Mr. Rockefeller, and it's not a good ending at all for his daughter, who, from all accounts, she had a very loving father, despite his own personal history. So just on that note, and then we can take a break now and start talking about the child custody in the state with our guest tonight, Mr. Bob Norton, who's a activist for divorce court reform.
So we'll take a quick break. Hello, welcome back to The Father's Corner. Again, I'm Byron Watson. Seated next to me is Joe Jurenik, and our esteemed guest Bob Norton is here. He's going to give us some insight concerning the child support guidelines and the other financial matters related to the probate court. Bob, thank you for coming again. We are very grateful that you had the opportunity to come here.
You're welcome. Happy to be here. And, you know, we're working hard to get the word out on this because the system is really so money-driven and perverse at this point that we think just people knowing the facts will begin to change the system.
Well, I guess the most common question, Bob, is many people think that the child support guidelines are unfair considering the cost of housing and then the economic situation presently. I know you're very well informed on the guidelines and the Commonwealth's handling of the child support guidelines. What is your opinion and your personal knowledge of whether the guidelines are excessive as far as the amount that they demand?
Well, yeah, there's no question they're excessive. Pretty much any high school student could do the math and figure out what's fair and reasonable, which would be to take, you know, the average basic costs of raising a child and divide it over the 18 years and then weekly, and hopefully split that in two, assuming, you know, that the bulk of the time that there's two income earners in the household. Granted, there might be adjustments for that. But, you know, over 85% of families now have two earners, so there ought to be some equity split. If you do that and you compare it to what the numbers are today, you can easily mathematically prove that in Massachusetts, which is the highest child support in the nation, not only in absolute dollars, because we do have a higher cost of living, but as a percentage of income, it's also the highest, and that's kind of self-adjusting. As your salary goes up, the amount you pay goes up. But I could easily make the mathematical argument that the basic situation with one child, what is being ordered by Massachusetts, is about 4 to 5 times what is fair and reasonable. If you look at the USDA, the United States Department of Agriculture, that has research on what the cost of raising a child is, it's about $118,000 today total over 18 years from birth until a child is old enough to go out on their own. And so if you take that number and you divide it over the 18 years and then you divide it by 52 weeks, and then you cut that in half for two parents paying equal amounts, which has been proven better for the children, by the way, to have joint custody relationships where there's equal participation of both parents, you wind up with a figure of about $47 to $50 a week as being kind of the maximum basic cost of a child. Now, this is taking out some for housing, because both people have to pay for housing, and that's about 35% of the cost overall. But basically, any high school student could do this math. The problem we have is that the people that design these guidelines have a conflict of interest. It's done by lawyers and judges who want these amounts to be as high as possible, because they're basically in a situation where they make more money in the battle when there's more money at stake.
Well, that brings up an interesting point, Bob. You talk about the conflict of interest and the financial gain for the judges and the lawyers. I received information, we've made this comment in the past on the show, about the advantages of the Commonwealth in issuing restraining orders because they receive compensation from the federal government.
Yeah.
It's my understanding that with child support, that the government kind of the state kind of double dips also, that when they demand child support from the non-custodial parent, which is usually the father, biological father, that the Commonwealth also receives money from the federal government.
That's correct. As a matter of fact, we're talking about billions of dollars per year that come as incentives from the federal government into the states. Massachusetts last year received about $140 million, which is essentially enough to pay for the whole probate court system in essentially what I would call kickbacks based on child support orders. And so every judge in Massachusetts has a direct conflict of interest, because essentially when they order $100 a week in child support, their judicial department winds up getting about $33 a week for up to 23 years. So there's a tremendous perversion caused by these federal funds, not only in the restraining order incentives, but in child support as well. That's called Social Security Act Title 4D. And it was put in place in the Clinton administration with probably the reasonable and honorable attempt to begin to give people incentives to get off welfare so that parents weren't getting out from under these things. But as always happens in government, the government and the people in the lower levels start gaming the system. And so essentially they implemented policies and procedures that little by little get worse and worse each year, which maximize the benefit to those people in the system instead of we the people. So you wind up with, it's what I call a corruptocracy, which is a bureaucracy where each level does what's in its own best interest for them personally instead of staying on mission of what the overall goal is, which should be serving, you know, we the people, and doing the minimum amount that's necessary to ensure fairness and support. And I've interviewed three constitutional lawyers on this, and every one of them have said that the Massachusetts, not only the guidelines, but the whole Massachusetts probate system is run unconstitutionally. Many of the things they do are violating the civil and constitutional rights of people. For instance, anyone that reads the Constitution will see that when the state takes away any right of yours, you have a right to a jury trial if that amount is over $20. Well, in our Massachusetts probate system, someone just struck that from the probate rules or procedures and said, no, you can't have that anymore. Well, the jury trial is the check and balance on unfair laws for people, and our founding fathers put it in place so that there would be those checks and balances between the three branches of government, the executive, the judicial, and the executive is supposed to watch over the judicial. And those things have been removed. And so what we have is a system where the foxes are guarding the hen house.
Yes.
It sounds, unfortunately, when you were talking about the good intentions of the Clinton administration when they changed these laws a few years back, that what comes to mind immediately is that the road to hell is paved with good intentions, and so we find ourselves in this situation where we have a lot of bad things happening. And I know that you're aware of many fathers when they find themselves in the situation of not being able to pay the child support, they're faced with incarceration. And so you have many fathers who are in a court, and I know we know one instance this, in the last few days where a father was in court, and in front of his children he was sentenced to 30 days in jail. And he basically, as many fathers do, have to go to friends and relatives to get the money to get out of jail. So it's a very corrupt and perverse system that's in place now.
Yeah,
it's certainly not a system that helps families and strengthens families to stay together.
Yeah, it's lost touch with its own purpose, which is to help families and to make sure there is accountability for both parents to be participating, and not only in the financial aspect, but also the emotional and upbringing and learning and teaching. Because all the research shows that children do enormously better, not like 10% or 50% better. They do better by a factor of 6 to 24 on every single thing we can measure when there's an equal parenting relationship with a near 50-50 split in time. There's not a single study in the world that says sole custody is good for children, and yet Massachusetts judges are awarding 85% sole custody. That literally makes them, and this will sound like a radical statement, but it's a scientific fact, that literally makes our divorce judges in Massachusetts the most prolific child abusers in the country.
Do you have any...
That's considered child abuse at this point, sole custody, because what happens is you have more crime, you have more drug usage, you have kids dropping out of school, you have more gang violence.
Teenage pregnancies.
Mental health issues. I mean, the cost of this is literally trillions of dollars. And so what we have is a system that's forcing a wedge between the two parents for the profit of the system, and particularly the lawyers, but to some degree the judges as well. And the end result is 5 and 10 and 15 years out. But it is correlated directly to what they're doing. Fatherlessness is actually the root cause of most of our social pathologies with children today.
Sure. Well, and I'm sorry, go ahead,
Byron. What I was going to say is, you know, I would argue this, Bob, I'm sure you have a comment. Presently, the way they have the child support set up is almost like sharecropping, because the non-custodial parent is put in a position financially quite often where there's no way they can possibly overcome this hurdle, because if their income is X amount of dollars and they have to pay a third because the child support is based on the gross as opposed to the net, and they can't survive, meet the basic necessities, if they get additional revenue from another job, then the custodial parent has the opportunity to go in and ask for more money, which unfortunately judges will be abusive and require them to pay more money. Mm-hmm. So it's a rock that they can never get from underneath.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, we, as Joe said, we literally have people going to jail because they lost a job, because they had a heart attack. I mean, I know a guy who spent a year in jail because he had a heart attack. And he got behind on child support, and the system just keeps going like a steamroller, and it criminalizes and crushes people. And they get to the point where they're paying so much child support they can't afford a lawyer. So whatever problems they have continue to compound and get worse. And then the state loads interest and penalties and legal fees. And when you're found in contempt, you have to pay the other side's legal fees. So suddenly the fees associated with child support collection now become more than the child support itself.
Yes.
And people are put in situations that are just completely unmanageable. We actually have about 330 suicides a month in the United States as a result of what the divorce courts are doing. And there's about an 11-to-1 ratio between men and women that are committing suicide because they feel no hope. They're crushed by the system. They have no way out. They're forced into poverty. Their children are taken away from them. Their dignity is taken away from them. They're essentially criminalized. Some of them will drop out of society. They'll go on the run. They'll leave the country. They'll do things like Mr. Rockefeller. I mean, clearly he snapped. And you know, I'm not here to say he's a good man. I don't know. But it is clear that his, even though he was the primary caregiver, his custody was terminated by the court for the benefit of the women, or the woman in that case, even though she was off working, you know, 60 and 80 hours a week. And suddenly he became a bad father as soon as the divorce happened. Now, I don't know the specifics of that situation, but what I know is that standard operating procedure in Massachusetts.
Yes.
Yeah, they want to maximize the money they take out of the family in its number one time of crisis as it's the family is struggling through a divorce. And, of course, that's a strain in itself financially because you have to go from one home to two. So it's almost impossible in the average situation to maintain a standard of living. Everyone's standard of living is going to go down a little bit because typically there's the same income, and it now has to support two households.
And a related comment, another issue is that the custodial parent, they don't really take in consideration her income the custodial parent, I won't give it a gender, until $19,500. So it's really more advantageous for certain people, especially the more lower income, for the custodian parent not to work because they can just be supported.
Well, technically that rule went away when the new guidelines went in place in January because that used to be the rule. It was about, didn't count their income until they made about $20,000. But with the new guidelines, it's much more convoluted and it's complicated on purpose. They raised the child support even though it's already the highest in the nation. And for some people, it went up 40%. So what they did is outrageous, and it proves the level of blindness and or corruption that is in the system. You know, we have the foxes running the hen house, and you can't expect them to fix it. We need the legislature to work on this. We need the people to be aware of it, which is why we do communications and PR and shows like this, because this is literally just totally out of control. I mean, this is ruining people's lives for the convenience and profit of the divorce industry. And make no mistakes, the divorce industry is a for-profit industry, and every decision it makes is to increase its own profit on a day-to-day basis. To think that these people care about what's best for children and what's for best for families, unfortunately, is naive. Now, it took me a long time to study that and figure it out, and I didn't believe that when people told me that myself. But I've now studied this industry for over 5 years. My background and expertise is in management and design of businesses and systems and processes. So I say that not just as a father who's been abused by the system, but as an expert in business and management and processes. This system is completely incompetent in how it administers divorce and the whole child support system. It's unconsciously incompetent, which is the lowest level of learning on the four scales of learning. It's so incompetent, it doesn't even know it's incompetent.
I would tend to respectfully disagree. I think that is intentionally corrupt. I think this is done intentionally by legislators who are more concerned about favoring certain political groups and committees in order to further their political goals. The same thing goes for justices of the Commonwealth and some who have indifference, either or apathy, or basic bias based on gender, race, or social income.
Right.
I personally think it's intentional. Every act is intentional.
Well, we're talking about two slightly different things, and I'm going to agree with you. And those two things aren't mutually exclusive. The reason I agree with you is I think the system systemically is totally corrupt. I also believe on a case-by-case basis, most of the 42 probate judges in Massachusetts have been corrupted by money. They are not administering law, they are administering policy. And what they do is breaching the U.S. Constitution, it's breaking the Massachusetts statutes, and it's ignoring the U.S. Supreme Court in what it said about the rights of parents. So you can look at this whole system and talk about the whole system being corrupted by money. It's almost a Darwinian thing where the pressures and the day-to-day pressures that happen are to get the most money. But, you know, I agree with you. It's hard to believe that all 42 judges would be bad people who would be willing to intentionally break the law. But what has happened, it's like the proverbial frog in the pot, where the temperature is turned up little by little every year, and the frog doesn't jump out, he gets cooked. This has happened little by little by changes of policy. And I know in my case, my judge broke the law 36 times. I mean,
it becomes a matter of...
I took training as a court watcher. Sure. I went to the pro se courses. I read the law. I knew exactly what was going on. They take advantage of people that don't speak up for their rights and don't know the law, again, to maximize the revenues of the system. So I agree with you. There's a lot of corrupt people in the system, but the system itself is systemically corrupt, and that's the bigger problem.
And then they further impede your ability to fight the corruption by denying you any sort of counsel.
Yes.
Unfortunately, you have several groups that are pro bono that receive state and federal funds. Unfortunately, they won't assist the male.
Yes, I agree with you. All of the VAWA funds for Violence Against Women Act and other things, they themselves are unconstitutional because they're only administered in a sexist kind of way.
Let me just interject. I think we have to wrap up, but let me just make a quick point, which is I think that what you've said is really right on the money in a lot of ways, except the one thing that we have to realize is this kind of problem happens to everyone. If someone's out there in a family and they feel safe and secure, that could turn upside down at a moment's notice with one side saying they want a divorce. If there's children, you're in great danger. The whole life can be upset. And that's why this is so troubling, because so many people are caught unawares by the problems.
Yeah, pretty much everyone is touched by it. Even though the divorce rate is only 40 to 50%, everyone has friends and families and sisters and brothers that are just crushed by
this. Like everything else, AWARI seems in the delusion of security, it'll never happen to me, or how did it come to that?
Right.
I hate to cut it so short, but again, I thank you for coming stopping by, Bob. And again, this is the Father's Corner. We've had another episode, and we look forward to you coming to our next show in 2 weeks. We have to end it. It's time for us to go. Thank you very much.
Should I get down the URL? Get in there. Maybe they can put...
The more I could see how much he loved my mother and my brother and me, and he did the best that he could, and I only hope when I have my own family, every day I see a little more of my father in me. See, he loved my mother and my brother and me, and he did the best that he could, and I only hope when I have my own family, every day I'll see, oh, I hope I see, I hope every day I'll see. Mm-hmm.